right, good evening. Welcome back, everyone who's already been here for our budget workshop. We will now begin the regularly scheduled April meeting of the Midland Public Schools Board of Education. At this time, I ask that everyone turn off their cell phones. It interferes with our TV feed, so if you would do that, please. And at this time, we will stand and say the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Once again, Scott, if you would take roll call.
Certainly. President Brandstatt.
Here.
Vice President Singer.
Here.
Treasurer Frazee.
Here.
Member Baker.
Here.
Member Blasey.
Here.
Member Fidel.
Here.
We have a quorum.
Excellent. Moving into item 6, which is our consent agenda. 6.1 is approval of the regular meeting minutes from March 20th, 2017. 6.2 is recommending Casey Damon, hopefully I pronounced that right, for mathematics teacher. 6.3 is a tenured teacher requesting a leave of absence for the remainder of the year. 6.4 are the staff development proposals. These were all presented at our last board meeting and will be voted on tonight. 6.5 is waste and recycled dumpster services. 6.6 is renewal of our Yo-and-Yo audit renewal. 6.7 is approval of payment of the school system's bills for the month of March. 6.8 are legal invoices for payment. Goes through 6.8. At this time, I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
All right.
Support.
All right. Moved by Scott, supported by Pam. Is there any discussion?
On item 6.1, approval of the regular meeting minutes from March 20th. Mm-hmm. Item 4.1 says all of these recommendations are awarded to the low bidders. That is accurate for four of the five categories of 411, video surveillance and access control is the cumulative low of two categories.
Okay. Oh, noted. All right. Is there any other?
I guess I would, on item 6.4, we went over these development proposals at a curriculum meeting. Mm-hmm. And they're focused at the students in closing the achievement gap and very supportive in every one of these areas and thrilled to be able to be investing in our kids in this way.
All right, thank you for that. And note that it also says that these are implemented based on available funding, and as we discussed in our last half hour. All right, any other comments? All right, at this time, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed? All right, consent agenda passes. Moving into item 7, which is Board of Education matters. First, we have our April Shining Stars.
We're going to start with Nicole Lloyd. Nicole, would you come up and join me? Nicole's coming up. I'll read a little bit about Nicole. Nicole began her employment with Midland Public Schools in 2015 as a Title I paraprofessional at Plymouth Elementary School. The position she holds today. Nicole earned her bachelor's degree from the University of Missouri, Columbia in 1988. Nicole was nominated for the Shining Star by several Plymouth staff members. Among their comments were the following. Students call her Mrs. L. Nicole has a big heart for all children, but especially has a gift for working with students who find learning hard or find school a tough place to be. She goes above and beyond daily to set up students for success. We are grateful to have her as part of our Plymouth team. Nicole is such a hard worker and lovely person to work with. She has such a gentle way with all children, but is certainly a cheerleader for those that struggle. It is not uncommon to see Nicole still collaborating, cleaning up the classroom, organizing, or helping prepare for the next day well after the bell rings. She works behind the scenes and never expects any recognition. Nicole is an inspiring, uplifting person. She maintains a positive relationship with all students and goes above and beyond her duties as paraprofessional. She is compassionate and always there to help in any way she can. Nicole is a shining star. I cannot imagine an employee who is more deserved of an award that recognizes above and beyond. Congratulations, Nicole. Our second shining star is Sandy Justice. Sandy will join me. And I'll read a little bit about Sandy as she comes up. Ms. Justice joined Midland Public Schools staff in 2002. Throughout Sandy's MPS career, she has been a life management teacher at Northeast Middle School and or Midland High School. Sandy earned her bachelor's degree from Western University of Michigan in 1981. Sandy was nominated for the Shining Star by several Northeast colleagues. Among their comments were the following. Sandy has gone above and beyond with her career students. She had her students create a banner for each of the Northeast classrooms to promote school spirit. Also during the week before Christmas break, Sandy had her career students create a survey to ask Northeast staff about their hot beverage preference. Once the students compiled the data from the survey, they created an online order form for Northeast staff to be able to order a hot beverage to be delivered the next morning. I had one of those. Sandy Justice ran a Thinking Cup Coffee with her careers class. They offered coffee and tea to all the staff at Northeast for an entire week. The students set the order form up on a Google Classroom. The students then arrived early every day and made drinks and delivered them with a smile. It was a nice treat during a hectic holiday season. The students seemed to enjoy this as much as the staff. Congratulations, Sandy.
Congratulations to both Nicole and Sandy. Thank you very much for all you do for our students. Moving into 7.2, Juvenile Care Center presentation.
Lori Pritchard will introduce everyone or get them started for us.
Okay. Hello, my name is Lori Pritchard, and I
have
to turn this on.
That's always a good thing.
Wait, turn it on? Oh, yes. Can you hear me now? My name is Lori Pritchard, and I'm the Supervisor of Educational Programs at the Juvenile Care Center. Thank you so much for having me. I have a posse of people here to support and to also speak tonight. And because I can't see you, because there's now a screen between us, if you would just please stand as I mention your name. We have here with us Michelle Bell, who is the Director of Court Services. Michelle, say hi.
Hello.
And we also have Diana LaRue, who is the Supervisor of Day Treatment Program, here with us. And we also have some speakers that will be joining me in a few minutes. We have Jolene, and we have Charlie, and Kayla, and Ava. And I think that covers it. I just wanted to say that as I come up here to speak, it's ironic that in the fall, it will mark the 20th year of the Juvenile Care Center being opened. In 2017, that will be 20 years. We opened up, and I say we because I was part of the initial instructional team back in 1997, and I've come full circle back to the Juvenile Care Center as I wrap up my career. I still have a few years to go. But anyway, it's just, it's been a joy to see the program come from where it was in 1997 and to where it is today. It's certainly a very different program, and thanks to a lot of the community agencies and to our school and to the people who support the program, it's made incredible leaps and bounds. Certainly, that started with the Honorable Judge Doreen, or Donna Morris, and continues on with Judge Doreen Allen, who are very, very strong proponents of supporting the educational system and school attendance and quality education, as we have partnered with them in the court since the Juvenile Care Center has opened. So part of the purpose of my coming here tonight, let me get to this part here. Let me figure out if I can do this. Oh, yeah, here we go. All right. Part of the reason why I wanted to come speak to you this evening is to talk to you. I know that there have been a lot of touring groups that come through the Juvenile Care Center, but some of those kinds of things, those pieces of information get lost in the shuffle as time goes on. Certainly, we had an opportunity to have some people come in who have gone through the program and would be considered seriously brave souls who have navigated and succeeded through the programs, and they'll talk to you a little bit tonight. But I also want to dispel kind of some of the misnomers about how kids get into the day treatment detention facilities. First, it's important for you to understand that, as it's indicated up here on the slide, there really are two majorly different programs that are part of the Juvenile Care Center. The first is the day treatment program, which is, it generally runs from about 7:30 in the morning until 7:30 at night, and takes in about 20 to 22 students. And that encompasses a program that involves a school program, which is about 8:30 in the morning until about 3:15 in the afternoon. And then students progress through programs. They call them supplemental programs or dosage hours. And we'll talk a bit about what those programs look like and other things like chores and eating, dining, those kinds of things. So those are part of the day treatment program. Students who are part of the day treatment program go through a rigorous screening compilation, really. And it helps to identify students who may have a school need. Perhaps they're struggling academically with attendance or even just performance, but also perhaps with their families. The structure of their family is maybe atypical or not supportive. Or lastly, the third category of whether they have maybe the just life skills or maybe life attitudes that would lend them to be successful in the future. So those are the three basic criteria that would help to identify students who might benefit from the day treatment program. The detention program, on the other hand, is really considered a maximum security juvenile jail. And it houses kids, both the day treatment and the detention programs, the students have to be adjudicated, which means that the judge determines that they have become eligible for this. They have gone through court proceedings to have a place in day treatment or detention. And the detention kind of is a continuum, really, where students might come in for very minor infractions, like such as a violation of probation, maybe a minor in possession of tobacco even, which would be considered a pretty minor thing in a big scheme, or maybe even truancy, whereas it could be something as serious as homicide. We house kids from counties all around the state of Michigan. We have beds that are reserved for both Midland County and for out-of-county kiddos. And generally, the age ranges for both day treatment and detention are 11 to 17. So that's how students land in day treatment and detention. In the detention program, it's primarily the school program, which runs from the same times, 8:30 to about 3:15. And then they also have some after-hours programs, but it's more grouped based on the group rather than on the individual student's needs, as it is in the day treatment program. In the school, which is how I got to speak here today, there are basically three Midland Public Schools personnel, three and a half, I should say, three instructors. Myself, I teach in the detention segment, and I also do the administrative functions. And then our teacher here, Ms. Sarah Peratt and Ms. Wendy Thomas. And the three of us have worked with at-risk populations for over 15 years, and we're all certified special education teachers. The teachers in day treatment do a combination of direct instruction and online instruction that's provided by Ingenuity primarily. And mostly a lot of very, very individualized considerations with each student who comes in. And when I say individualized, I'm talking about they look at, I'd say 90% of the students who come in have a gap with credits. If they're high school age, they're missing credits or they're behind because they maybe were truant and they didn't receive credit, or because they had failed a course or two or three or more. And so they look at doing a transcript analysis right from the get-go. And we look at individualizing the educational components so that they can make up those credits. And then secondly, because we're all certified to teach special education, we implement to its fullest extent the IEP if they qualify for any learning disability or any other handicapping condition which needs any kind of an accommodation. So that's kind of the educational program in a nutshell. No, not that way. Okay, here we go. The other programs that come into play after the school hours are the programs that the court personnel implement and facilitate. And one of the things, I like to see Pam here, but you know, that she and the Legacy Center have really, really helped all of us as a community to really come to terms with and understand better is the 40 developmental assets. And considering those external and internal assets, I like to call them just the tools in the tool belt for kids' success. And we talk about how in the middle school, around seventh grade, these assets start dropping off, and that's what makes children and students more susceptible to making at-risk choices and taking more, making more at-risk decisions in their life. So the program, when I looked at all of the programs that are available at the Juvenile Care Center, I sketched them all in terms of where they fit on the 40 developmental assets list. And as you can see with my chicken scratch, that they're all over the place. And some of them are redundant and copied many, a couple places. So the program in itself as a collective unit, the Juvenile Care Center, really, really goes to look at the gaps in the families and in the students' lives and tries to fill some of those holes so that they're better equipped in their tool belt to be successful. And here are some of the list of the program options that are available. And as I was mentioning, very, very individualized. So when a kiddo comes in and they've gone through those screening tools, which this isn't my expertise, but there's a YASI assessment and a MAISI and a GAIN, and they all assess different parts of a child's needs. Like, for example, if they have a drug abuse problem, substance abuse problem, the GAIN would assess whether or not they have that need. The other assessments talk about their mental health. Another assessment talks about their inclination towards criminal behavior, those kinds of things. So wherever those needs are, these are where the programs come in. And specifically, and as I'll mention, these particular tools or strategies, aggression replacement therapy or thinking for a change, family ties, strengthening family, victim impact, substance abuse counseling, recovering youth futures, MST or multi-systemic therapy, common sense parenting, those are all specific programs where they receive dosage hours. So when the judge says you have to earn 400 dosage hours, and that could be a really way off number, but then those are the program hours where they obtain those hours towards completing the program. The other programs that are listed up there are other programs available, not just to the student, but also to the whole unit as a family. And that's where in considering, this is really the single most, we talked a lot about at-risk money, and as I was sitting there, one of the kiddos that I worked with said, is this meeting about at-risk money? Is that why we're here? Ironically, there is no connection. I just signed up for a very late time in the year to present because I wanted to make sure I had enough information. But it fell in tied nicely. So what I was going to say is, the cliche phrase that says it takes a village to raise a child, and we talk about these programs provided by these community agencies, and I'm sure I left off one, and I don't want to leave any out, but I did as best as I could. We think about it really truly does take a village and then some to provide some of the needs for some of our kids. Okay, so enough about me. Although I do want to say before I transition to the next aspect of this that, as I mentioned earlier, I've kind of come full circle in my career, having started teaching in the day treatment program, and then I went on to be assistant principal at Midland High, and then assistant principal at Northeast. And I wouldn't say that, as I walk along next to some of the kiddos that I've had the opportunity to work with, and I say work with loosely because I'm relatively sure I have had no influence on the kiddo that went to West Point, or to the kiddo that did the internship at the White House, or that goes to the Peace Corps. It's the kids that we work with in terms of at-risk that we really celebrate, because we're looking at where they have the holes in their lives. Whether it be in their self-esteem or in their families or in their skills, and trying to empower these kids to build their own lives and have success. It's the kids that I'm going to, Jolene, you're still a kid. The kids I'm going to introduce you to in a few moments that are the reason why I get up every day, because they have, against all odds, really come to terms with their own needs, accepted help, and made positive changes in their own lives so that they could be part of this conversation tonight. So I'm really, really excited to introduce you to the four brave, brave people who we would say have successfully completed this JCC program. Jolene started in 1997 when it first opened, and Charlie, I think it was around 2003, and correct me if I'm wrong, Charlie, when you come up, but and then Kayla was more along the lines of 2013, and then Ava, our freshest, still trying to get out of high school, she just recently completed within the last year or so. So I'm going to ask them to speak a little bit about their experiences, but we really just, like I said, want to celebrate that they didn't get dealt the greatest poker hand, yet they played and they strategized and they came out certainly on top and winners in our game. So without further ado, I would like to introduce you to Jolene. Jolene, come on up here.
Hello.
Can everybody hear me?
Yep.
I wrote everything down. It's just
that
easier.
Works.
So my name is Jolene, and I was one of the first 13 at the JCC. She said 1997, but I believe it was 98. It was January of 98, I'm pretty sure. A little bit about myself. I grew up in an alcoholic and substance abuse home and lived on welfare for most of my life. I was introduced to the justice system at the age of 11. I continued to be a part of that for 4 years after. Petty theft, vandalism, assault and battery, a lot of violation of probation, substance abuse, which is where it kept me in the system. I was placed in Saginaw, Bay County, and Midlands detention centers, and at one point I was a resident at the Harbor House. At the age of 15, I found out I was pregnant, and I believe it was a week later they told me I was going to JCC, the day treatment program, which I spent the whole pregnancy at JCC. The day I was supposed to graduate was the day I went to labor, and so I consider that my my new beginning, my next chapter. Day treatment provided me with so many things, structure. It gave me clear boundaries and expectations. It made me accountable for my actions and showed me some responsibility. I found people that I looked up to, people that are still in my life today, who are proud of me, and I'm proud to be who I am because of them. I found worth in myself. I found worth in myself and the tools to better myself and better what my child was going to have. And so then I stand here today talking to you guys about how cool I am. And,
you are.
I have now where I am happily married. My daughter is 18 and attends CMU. She's going for neurophysician assistant. I probably scared her whole life because of all these things that I've learned myself that I've, you know, influenced her and told her, okay, this you can't do, this you can't do. I call them the rules. And I'll say, do you know the rules? And she'll say, yes, Mom, respect yourself, respect others, and don't do drugs. And I'm like, all right, we're good. I have lost track. Some of the other things that I have learned through day treatment throughout my life were communication, also family time, making sure that there is time set aside for my child, for my nieces and my nephews, and being involved in their life, and to assure them that no matter what, I'm always going to love them. Whatever they do, I'm always going to be there. So looking at me today, most people would not guess that I've had all of these life experiences. A lot of them are shocked when I say, hey, I'm 34 and I have a kid in college. Am I proud of it? No, but yes. I'm proud of who she's become. I'm proud of who I've become. I'm happily married. He's over there. And he also has those same goals, being supportive and being there. We took on my little sister, who was being raised, and it was a difficult transition to go from him not having any kids to two teenagers in the house, and I commend him for that, for sure. And as of right now, we're just enjoying our empty nest. Both girls have graduated, and now we're looking for retirement. And that's all I have. Do you have any questions for me?
No, thank you so much for talking to us tonight.
Thank you.
What a wonderful testimony.
That's very
don't ever hesitate when you say you're proud of yourself.
Oh, yeah, you should.
We're all proud of you, and thank you for sharing your story with us.
Thank you.
Absolutely amazing. Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you.
We may have a few more questions after we hear the others.
Mm-hmm. Perfect.
Charlie.
Hi. Hey, Charlie.
Are we live right now?
Yeah.
So everybody home can see this?
Yeah.
Oh. Yeah.
There you go.
Okay. And I work at Yaya, so I see some of you guys. All right. Okay. Hi, my name's Charlie Overstreet. I attended the day treatment program in 2003, between 2003 and 2004. I graduated after about 7 to 9 months. They gave me 5 minutes, so I'm gonna try to get it all in there. I can't really recall what month or year I entered into the juvenile court system. I do know I was in the eighth grade, and I would stay there until I was about 17. I've read over, well, actually, I was gonna read over these 40 developmental assets, and, well, I didn't really need to, actually. I didn't really need to, because I looked at it, and the first three, right off the bat, it, like, explained me to a T, and, the first one being family support. It goes on to say family life provides high levels of love and support. And at home, as a teenager, you know, I rarely felt like I was loved at home. There was not a lot of attention or affection in my house that I lived in. Okay, and then number two was positive family communication. Young person. And his parents communicate positively, and young person is willing to seek advice and counsel from parents. Again, there was not that much positive communication in my house as a teenager or a child. I was pretty much free to roam as I pleased. I didn't seek advice from my parents, considering we both knew we were involved in a lot of the same illegal activities, considering drugs, alcohol, and so on. And number three, this is the catch, that's what brings this whole daydreaming thing together, is other adult relationships, the young person receives support from three or more non-parent adults. And this is where juvenile probation, day treatment, foster care came into the picture. Everything that I was looking for in number one and number two, I had found in number three. So as a child, a teenager, I really just wanted a positive influence in my life, or positive people to be around, I should say. And when I got to day treatment, I found that. I didn't have a problem taking advice from their staff. I wrote all this down, by the way. I didn't have a problem taking advice from their staff. I feel I was very cooperative, and I knew that they were there just to help me out. I didn't mind the structure and the curfews, any of that stuff, because that's what I wanted at home. And I feel that's why I kind of made it look easy going through the program, is because I was cooperative. And I should have been getting all that stuff at home, you know. And I went from failing high school to passing with a C-plus average. And when I was close to completing the day treatment program, I knew everything would go back to how it was before I entered. So I talked to some of the staff, thank you, Diana, she's over there, about how I felt about going to a foster home. And I went, so I made that decision on my own. I got into the foster care system and continued to excel in school and outside activities. Again, it was that structure I needed in my life. I had chores, I had homework, I had a curfew, and I got allowance. That's everything a teenager needs. And I got it. You know, that's all I wanted. But I'd have to say that during my teenage years, all these experiences are the highlights of my adolescence. Today, I'm a father of three children. That's where that picture, that was the other day. I got twins. I got four-month-old twins. I got a four-year-old, and that's three poopy diapers in a row. That's the hat that I wear because I just can't handle the smell. So today I'm a father of three children. I've hung on to a lot of the things I went through and learned. And, when my kids are that age, teenager or childhood years leading up to that, then I'll take what I learned from the program and apply it to their life as well. They won't have to go to a staff member or a foster home looking for something that's missing, because I'll know what to do from the things I've learned. I don't know, the juvenile system, arts programs, it's not just a temporary solution, I guess. Some people actually get it. You know, some of the teenagers hang on to it, and they carry it with them. And a lot of people I know didn't make it after day treatment and juvenile, you know, but some of us did, like Ms. Pritchard had said, you know, and we've been through a lot, but some of us still made it. And I think the JCC Center for that, and I'll just continue to keep doing the next right thing. You know, it's what they taught me. So I think that's all I got. Thank you for having me. Hey, everybody at home, at the courthouse. It's nice to see you.
Thank you very much.
I can't get this thing right. I think I have it upside down or something. Okay. Okay, here we go. Kayla.
Hello, I'm Kayla Schneider, and I was part of the day treatment program during my senior year of high school for truancy. And I was on truancy because if I wasn't in class, I would find me most likely doing one of two things. One would be waking up and getting my three grade school age sisters at the time ready, fed, dressed, and to their school. And after that, I would preoccupy my time with experimenting with powders, pills, and rocks all under the sky. So that was what initially put me into the program, thankfully, is what I should say. But truancy is typically just the tip of the iceberg. I mean, yes, if you have a student and they're missing class, yes, it's their choice to do so most of the time, but there's underlying things that are going on in their house and behind closed doors that are probably motivating them to do other things other than stay in class, do their homework, do good typical priorities that teenagers would have. For example, behind my closed doors was my father, who's in prison on and off for my whole life, and then my three little sisters' father, who was abusive both emotionally and physically, and then my mentally ill mother. So you can understand that that would be a very toxic home to raise a kid and send it on its way to be a productive member of society. And unfortunate as it is, we've all seen the cycles that happen when kids are put in those situations. They also have kids, and they treat the kids with the same neglect and abuse that they were treated with. And you know, we've seen it, generations, families of just abuse and neglect. The JCC program is there to end cycles. It has all these groups, and it has all these resources and connections to get kids a proper support system to really excel them through life and put them on the right track and get them priorities. For example, the credit recovery. I would have never graduated on time if Miss Wendy and Sarah were not there on you, you know, getting your work caught up. And then also thinking for a change. Lori mentioned all the other supplement groups that they have there really do help us and form us into better members of society. And I'm sure you guys see downtown, it's growing, it's booming, and our youth is what's going to propel that. And JCC really sets up the youth to be the structure of that and gives them the social skills. I know new kids going into the program, I'm sure wouldn't be comfortable shaking someone's hand, introducing yourself, and looking in their eye. But as you go through the program, you gain the confidence and you gain those skills, and you get an idea of what you want your life to be, not what it ends up being because you don't really care. And you know, so it's amazing, really. And it also helps walk you through your at-home problems, and not like they can eliminate all of them. They can't control your family, and they can't control you, but it really gives you the tools and resources to cope with those and prepare for future ones, because they're going to be there. It teaches us our at-risk kids what we can't teach in class. It teaches us perseverance. It teaches us strength and resilience. And because of that, only 4 years later, I am graduating Delta College in 2 weeks now with an Associate of Health Fitness Specialist and a personal trainer certificate, as well as 6 months ago getting my own LLC to start my meal prep business. And this summer I'm looking into getting my own storefront and going on with life. And like Jolene said, looking at me today, you would never guess that. And I have the JCC and the Juvenile Care Center staff to thank for that. So thank you for your time. Thank you.
Can you tell us those pictures? What were those pictures from?
Okay, so something that's been awesome that I never would have imagined myself doing, this is trips I've taken in the last year. I went down, the most recent one's right here, took a solo drive down to North Carolina to go backpacking, met those wonderful people there, did some awesome hikes, did a lot of soul searching and finding down there, and really, I mean, going by myself and having that experience, I mean, it really made me realize the difference between being alone and being by yourself, and that was really great. This picture up here is me in a, went to Vegas, and one of my, on my bucket list, I have to street perform. And so it is a trash can dress that I made, and I would hide in a trash can in Vegas and jump out and scare people and make tips. So it's fun. Right there, I'm rock climbing, and then that's just another hike of mine, and that was a waterfall. It was so cool. That was the first one I've ever seen where it just goes ahead of you like a waterfall. It was so cool. Awesome. So
very neat.
Thank you.
Ava.
Hi, guys. I'm Ava Zielinski. I'm 16, and I'm a junior in high school right now. I got into the day tutoring program December 7th of 2015, and I got out October 15th of 2016, so I haven't even been out for a full year yet. You probably, if you just were to met me, never would have known that I haven't been out for a year. I came into day treatment with actually a lot of support system from my family. It was kind of, I was an odd case. I had everything I needed, and I didn't care for it. I became my little attitude self around eighth grade. Mrs. Pritchard got the first look at that of the angry little Ava I was. And I got into legal trouble for my first time for truancy my freshman year. And like previously said, truancy is just what you get into first, and then there's all the other problems that you're having. And then I got off probation, snuck by, I was like, I got out of here, I'm never gonna have to deal with it again. Well, got an MIP, I didn't listen to anything, and I got on and violated about 16 times before I had to learn my lesson. I was put into the day treatment center, I think, after my third violation. I didn't listen to anything anyone said first in day treatment at all. Didn't listen to my parents. I was still angry at pretty much everyone that tried to help me. I met a few staff in there, and Ms. Dye, and they really just, they wouldn't give up. They were just like, this girl has so much potential, why is she so angry? And they drilled me until this sparkly little creative Ava, who likes to paint and loves my family, came out, and they got me doing what I like to do. I like my hobbies. They brought me closer with my family. That's most of my pictures up here is me and my mom. I'm a huge family person now because, and I'm so blessed for it. I have my mom now that pushes me every single day to do like my 100% best. And she's always there for me. She's become my best friend, but also more importantly, my mother, who I now listen to. And I'm so blessed to have her in my life now, and so blessed that Miss Dye brought me and my mom together like that, and my whole family. It's like I felt like I had no one. I felt like I just was by myself, and I'm assuming that's why I was so angry and I opened up, and I'm really proud of who I've become today. I came into day treatment. I didn't want to graduate high school. Didn't want to go to college. I kind of just wanted to smoke pot in the basement for the rest of my life, but can't do that. Because you can't make a living off smoking pot in your basement. And you wouldn't have a basement if you did that. So now, the only thing that I am looking forward to after my 12 years of school is 12 more years of school. I want to be a forensic pathologist, and it's probably, if you ask any person that front row, the only thing I ever talk about. And I'm pretty excited for that, and I'm blessed that they all got me here. So thank you, everyone, for getting me to this point, and all of my friends coming tonight and letting me speak here and teach you guys about day treatment. And then there's one more thing I just forgot to say. Day treatment is discipline. Obviously, you got in trouble, you got in there, but it's so much more than that. It's solving a problem that there was, but you just got so many tools. Like, I'm probably never gonna be in legal trouble again because I learned young. I got all those tools handed to me now I can use when I'm older now. So thank you for that.
Thank you, Ava.
Thank you.
Okay, so in conclusion, I just want to say, and I know this was way longer than I had anticipated, but definitely, as you can see, worth it. This is our investment in our future and kids, and they certainly are going to make a difference in our lives. And looking forward, we want to just continue the educational partnerships with the court. They're doing a fabulous job of supporting us and helping make our impossible jobs possible by putting some teeth and some discipline and some attendance issues with supporting truancy and really helping us provide the supports that we need to carry out discipline and to provide help with some kids. Also, with the community partnerships, as you saw, with the extensive list of community agencies that come together to help these kids and families. And then lastly, just as a district, you know, looking forward and continue to invest in our kids, all of our kids. So, kids, come on back up. Even Jolene, when you get to be 30, then you're not a kid anymore, but you're always a kid.
So retirement.
I know, she did awesome. You guys did fabulous, and I'm so, so proud of you, and I'm not the only one, but I didn't know if there were any other questions that you guys may have had. Yeah, you gotta come to the mic.
I guess a statement first is when I first learned about the Juvenile Care Center, I thought it was a punitive place. A place to punish, and then I learned more, and when you brought up developmental assets, I about came out of my seat because I'm so excited about the positive things that everybody needs in their lives to really thrive and do well, and I couldn't be happier that those are the skills that you focus on with the students. And then to hear your stories, it's just so touching because you guys are strong, a wonderful, smart group of folks, and to see that you took the hand that you were dealt and you learned new skills and you rallied around with the adults around you and you've made these accomplishments. It's just truly fabulous, and a lot of credit goes to you and for the energy that they took and the passion and to come up here and to share your story, because I'll tell you what, there's not a person out there with those 40 developmental assets. Everybody's got something that they're missing in their lives, and you guys are great models in showing us that, you know, let's figure out what we're missing and find out how to get that. So thank you for that.
These are all friends and loved ones?
Yeah.
Behind here? Thank you. You guys did a great job. Kayla, one of the words that you said, I think, kind of resonates through everybody's story, and that is perseverance. Mm-hmm. The system didn't give up on you, and you guys are the end result of a brilliant process. More importantly, you didn't give up on yourself. Your family didn't give up on you. So there's always hope everywhere you go. I guess my question is moving forward, do you guys pay that forward? Do you mentor anybody? Do you interact with any of the new people coming into the system?
I mean, every time I know personally, if I know... personally, if I have a friend who I see is struggling or if I know they're having issues with one thing or another, you know, we all have them. I do what I can to be a supporting hand, be that listening ear that so many people were for me growing up and what I really needed. So along with every other skill, something that they do there is they lead by example. They don't tell you what to do and do something else. Every staff member has just the biggest heart, and they are willing to do that, and it's contagious, really. So absolutely, it's almost second nature now that we've been through it and we've been grateful enough to have those people do it to us. And yeah, every time you can, you try it, you know.
Do any of you else, any of the other, Jolene, Charlie, Ava?
I'm a mom, and so I am a mom to everyone. We've taken in my sister and moved her from a not so great environment to something that she can look forward to calling home. My daughter's friends, where I've had a friend stay at the house for a whole week one time just because she needed away from her mom. And then so then you're like, well, these are my life experiences, and this is what I think that maybe would help you, and how about you try writing a letter or doing something, you know, to just get the communication going. But most definitely, I'm one to give the best advice.
That's great.
With paying it forward, the like groups did a huge job with that, definitely T4C. I find myself doing to me and my friends, like, someone's getting really angry, I'm like, stop. Think, which is the first step. That's what you do, you stop and think. And so I find myself, like, one of my friends over there, like, about to make one of those decisions where it's like, don't do it, and I like have to call them, like, stop, let's think this through this scenario, what's actually going to happen, let's break it down. So I'm happy that I was the one friend who actually got in trouble, because I'm able to help them, and then I can prevent all the people that I love from getting in trouble. So yes, I pay it forward as much as I can.
Yeah, I try to stay connected with the court system, and I've kind of, like I should say, rubbed elbows with some of those guys, Ms. Dye. Like I said, I try to stay connected with them, and in doing that, they have the Impact program. I didn't know about it until a couple years ago, but you know, I get to go back and talk to the kids in the juvenile and in the day treatment, and it's. You know, I benefit from it, and I hope they do too, because I can see myself, you know, I can see myself in all of them. So, yeah, that's how I kind of give back, you know, to them. Thanks.
Thank you.
I just wanted to say I admire you guys for your courage to get up here and talk, for taking hold of your own life and making something that was not positive positive for yourself. I jotted down, you're such an inspiration, you know, that you're taking the time to help others. Charlie mentioned applying what I learned, you know, and giving that to your kids, having that up front. Kayla said, end the cycle of what not to do, learning those social skills, strength, resilience. And Ava, you said, every day do my best, and being blessed. And you guys are a blessing to others, so keep that in mind. Keep doing what you're doing. Thanks.
Diana, Michelle, and Lori, thank you for everything you've done. This is fabulous.
We'll
be back next year.
Yeah.
All right.
I was going to say,
you all mentioned proud, and that just explains it. You all should be so proud of you, and we're all very proud of you, and the poise and the skills that you have learned. You are far beyond many, many other adults. I mean, you've been through so many things that most adults and people haven't. But boy, the poise and the knowledge that you have, the life skills now at your ages, are going to take you a long way. And I think key of what you said is you've learned so much that you want to give it back and help others. And that is huge. And you are very blessed with some of your adults. I've known Mrs. Pritchard for a long time. And you are very, very fortunate to have her in your life as well. So thank you for sharing your stories and continue to share them. Be proud of who you are.
So yeah, thanks for taking the time to come speak with us tonight. Courage that it took to do that. So good luck with your retirement.
Thank you.
All right.
And it's not mandatory that you stay for the rest. Yeah. If you want to sneak out, you are free to stay.
All right.
Thank you.
Thanks, you guys. All right, moving into item 8, Board of Education Matters, presentation to the board for action. So we have Central Park Elementary furniture purchase.
Go ahead, Bob.
There we go. This is the first, or actually two phases, I should say, of furniture purchases for Central Park, which you just visited, and of course there wasn't any furniture in there. So of course we have to do that. It is, you know, I don't know if I can fully describe all the furniture, but they all are kind of modern versions, so students can have a little bit of movement when they want to and don't want to sit still, but can still be in their chair and moving a little bit. A lot of flexibility with all the furniture. Desks fit together in different ways, so they can do group work or they can be individual, all those kinds of things. Depending on, and that's why you see the three phases mentioned here, depending on what type of furniture and what part of the building they're going to be in, that's why you're seeing different phases and different people that we buy the furniture from. They also use, it's interesting to me, but they typically have worked across this country giving different states and different organizations pricing. And so when we get the pricing, I think we were joking earlier today, but it might be from Pennsylvania because that's the best price. You can't even go to the manufacturer and get the better price than what they offered there. So they go through kind of that reciprocal pricing as they go through to find those. And so you're seeing the first two phases that are there. Phase three is not too far behind that, but the first phase basically takes care of the general classrooms, the STEM labs, makerspaces, resource rooms, and the second ones are for the specialty kind of areas, gateway, music room, art room, media center, and those kinds of things. And they're two different companies there, but we are recommending those two purchases for a total of $681,000.
All right, do we have a motion?
Yes, so moved.
All right.
Support.
Moved by Mary, support by Scott. Is there any discussion?
The furniture's awesome.
Yeah, we got to see it. Was it 2 times ago at FFO we saw?
Mm-hmm. So perfect to provide different kinds of seating for kids that can't sit still, or and just the mobility and way that you can configure it for different uses is just right spot on.
And Barry, I think, you know, there was different by grade too. Yep. So as you progress, you get older.
I mentioned you have the auditorium seating mock-up over there. as well as happens to be in the boardroom tonight. And so the cloth seat is the general seat on a lower level. Mm-hmm. And the wood back seat is the upper balcony area.
Excellent. Well, check that out after the meeting ends. All right, is there any other discussion on the Central Park Elementary furniture? Nope. All those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed? All right. Next up, item 9 is request to address the board. Does anyone like to address the board? All right, moving into item 10, curriculum instruction and assessment. And it looks like there was a study committee on March 20th.
So absolutely.
We have the minutes.
I would be glad to. March 20th, 2017 at 2:15, the curriculum instruction and assessment study committee met. That we discussed staff development proposals. The curriculum office administrators shared information with the committee on the staff development process and the staff development proposals that were submitted for consideration. We voted on those tonight. The 15 proposals addressed a diverse array of subjects, continued Google applications training to co-teaching best practices. Several proposals focused on initiatives targeted at closing the achievement gap. These proposals will be brought to the March Board of Education meeting for public examination and to the April Board of Education meeting for action, which we had tonight. Implementation will be based on the available funds in the 2017-18 budget. Also discussed was blended online learning audit. MPS was notified in mid-March that our blended online learning programs will be audited before spring break. Chris Sabrin and Dave Dietzick are currently leading a team of staff members preparing for the visit. We adjourned at 3:55, and that's it.
Thank you. Moving into item 11, which is FFO, and we had a study committee meeting last Monday. So, Patrick?
Yes, minutes from April 10th. Two major topics were discussed, bond work update and finance. Under the bond work update, Mr. Dumbro from Barton Mallow provided a general construction update of the bond projects. At Central Park Elementary, the auditorium, Woodcrest, Plymouth, and the secure entries district-wide. The pending purchase of Central Park furniture was also discussed, including the use of nationwide cooperative state bid pricing, which we just went through. Second topic was finance. Mr. Cooper and the committee reviewed the February financial reports. Additional topics discussed by the committee were the renewal of the building cleaning contract with EnviroClean, the audit engagement letter with Yo and Yo for 16-17, and the remaining employee groups and their compensation benefits for 17-18. Next meeting is scheduled for Monday, May 8th at 5 o'clock.
Thank you very much. Moving into 11.2.
Hey, first, for informational purposes, I have 7 gifts, total value of $12,575. Like always, from a variety of sources, from parent advisories, local businesses, from individuals, even one highlighted in, I think, today's communique in honor of a teacher, which was kind of a nice gift, and then some from different endowment funds. There are, though, under 11.3, 3 gifts because of the amount of money involved that total $19,707.28. That need your approval to accept. One's for just over $6,000 for whiteboard skins, putting up whiteboards over existing chalkboards. Northeast Middle School Boosters Club, $7,000 from the Dowhai Music Boosters Club for various things for the music program, and $6,500 from Ken Lou Walt Education Fund to be used for the Chemic Challenge at Midland High. And they need board action tonight for acceptance.
I motion to approve items 11.3.
Support.
All right, moved by Pam, support by Mary. Is there any discussion?
A big thank you for all the donations, over $6,000 from Northeast Middle School Booster Club. And it's neat to see them invest in something like skins for whiteboards. Impacts all the classes and all the students, so what a creative way to spend the money. And the $7,000 for the music program at Dow High and $65,000 for Chemic Challenge, just a big thank you.
All right, all those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed? All right, thanks to the community. I think many, many schools were touched this month by donations. All right, moving into item 12, correspondence to and from the Board of Education. You can read those things in the agenda. 13, scheduled activities. Just to note, our next board meeting will be May 15th. And then we move into item 14, which is study discussion section. So, Pam, I'll start with you.
Really appreciated the presentation tonight, and it was very touching. And I'm passionate about developmental assets, so to see a program that just focuses so much on helping kids get what they don't find at their home. And when the one young man talked about when he first read the first three assets, the support, the positive family communication, and other adults in his life, and he had none of those in the top three. And to think, wow, how hard that had to be to have someone give you tools and realize that right off the get-go, you're behind the eight ball. And how this team at the Juvenile Care Center and Doreen Allen have impacted not only these kids but the community. And I see just so many positive things from the bronze sculpture in Doreen Allen's court wards that I think it was Kurt Gledhill years ago worked with the students and made this wonderful depiction of what freedom in Midland has been. And now it's on two walls in our court wards, and the kids who were part of that process were so engaged and not only felt great about that process, but felt that what they did really mattered. And that's what I get so excited about is they look specifically at what kids are lacking in their lives, and then they program around it. And it's not just them. It can be the community center. It can be partner groups. And I just feel so fortunate in Midland to have so many opportunities to partner with organizations that really want the best for kids. And that was just one shining example tonight. That's all I have.
Me?
I want to put thank you out to the staff that are going to be involved this summer in developing those proposals, working over the summer to help close that achievement gap. So that's all I have.
Thank you. Scott?
I don't have anything to add. Pam did a really nice job with her summation of the evening.
All right, yes. Patrick?
I agree. It was every week, every month we hear presentations, and every month it's this month is better than last month, and I didn't think that's possible, but very humbling tonight to hear that. Want to say congrats to Margaret Doan at Plymouth. She will be the new permanent principal, I guess is the correct way of saying that. And also to Mr. Lauer, who's taken on a new challenge, new role for the schools. I appreciate that as well. And then with the budget, it's hard to overlook all the work. I've come into the easy part of it in the last 2 years. All the work that's been done here in tonight, putting money back into the reserve fund, and that we're actually ahead of it for, well, maybe not ahead of it, but we're with it for once.
Very careful
how we word this, but it's easy to take for granted all the hard work that's gone into that, making that possible through everybody here, the teachers. 7 years of no raises, that's powerful stuff.
Pat, you have two more years, you can get ahead of it. I would just say Juvenile Care Center, it's an awesome place. It was one of the first projects that I got to work on after college. My company did the electrical work there, and to learn of all the people that were putting that together and all the time and effort and all the tours. You think you have a lot of tours going on at Central. There was tons of tours going on there to get everybody on board and to learn what they planned and what their vision was. And it's amazing what their vision has produced and the progress that they've made. And see the product that they produce. And to break the chain, break the cycle, all the things that they do, that's simply amazing. And for our tour today at Central Park, those craftspeople are doing a phenomenal job. It's clean, it's safe, and it is something you can tell that they take pride in because they get to do something that they don't get to do every day with special windows and special items and having all of the trades visible to all the students and everybody that goes through there. Mm-hmm. Takes a whole different effect, and you can tell that there's extra time going into all those steps.
Thanks. Lynn? I would piggyback on and what other people have said, and with the juvenile center here, I remember when they were talking about building that 20 years ago, and there was some controversy and concern about what this place was going to be and what it was going to do. And I think 20 years later, Judge Morris had her dream fulfilled, and we're seeing the product right, you know, as we saw tonight. I think it's incredible what they do, and it's a neat place to go visit. It really is, to see what they're doing. Central Elementary School visit today, like Brad said, unbelievable. Each time I've gone in there, I just get more and more excited. So I said, I wish I had a little one that I could send over there and be a little bit more of a part of it. Now I'm really excited to see the furniture go in, since I'm hearing about all the furniture. Thanks, Bob, for the budget report. I always appreciate it. You make it easy for me to understand, so hopefully others can understand it. And it's nice to see some positive notes as we go forward with our budget. Shining Stars, it's always a treat to celebrate them. And I've known Sandy Justice for a long time. And boy, going to Northeast on the day she's baking, you won't want to leave. that just wafts right down the hall, those good smells. And lastly, I believe Midland High is performing Shrek this weekend. Mm-hmm. So you want to go out for some fun entertainment out, they will be performing at Bullet Creek. And so next year, I was thinking today on our tour, next year, we'll be back probably at the our own auditorium.
I have a feeling we're going to have to stand in line to get tickets next year.
Yeah. So anyway, that's all I have.
All right. Well, I think I echo what everybody else said. And also, I think since the last board meeting, I had an opportunity to judge at the robotics competition at Dow High. Wow, very, very impressive. And then, of course, because I did that, I was very interested in what went on this weekend, too. And I know it was in our Monday communique, but huge congratulations to the teams from Midland and Dow High, who both have qualified for the World Championship that will be, is it next weekend? Two weekends from now. So very impressive. They both ranked so high when you looked at the total number of schools. And I mean, they were both very impressive at Dow High too. And then one student from Dow High who was nominated coming out of the local event here for the Dean's Award is now one of the 14 to go on. I saw that was also in the communique. My daughter also told me that last night because I was very curious how he was progressing. So very, very impressive students that I got the chance to interact with, and great things. I thought, you know, anyone who goes there would want to support that type of event. So these kids are doing incredible things. So, and thanks too for all the work that you all have done on the budget. Once again, I think every year I say cautiously optimistic. So, and once again, it looks that way. So thanks for all the hard work. I will turn it over to you.
All those good things going on, I want to talk about a potential good thing, I think, in the long run. Hopefully it's seen that way, and that's high school graduation for 2018. We surveyed our community and looked at alternative locations, the conflict of them both being the same time, same night. And if you've been caught in one of those hot, humid gymnasiums with, I'm sure the parents have it worse than we do sitting in chairs on the stage, but sitting at those bleachers with no backs on them, there was positive movement to move forward. And as we began to continue that discussion because of that movement, we realized, oh boy, the loons were very cooperative, but it may not be as easy to use the Dow Diamond as we thought. The schedule for 2018, at first it looked real favorable, but the date that they have available There are a few options where they could try to cram it in a night and then play a game that evening or the next day, and they're not really willing to try that the first year. Mm-hmm. They'd like to try a year where they have a little bit of time in between just in case the field doesn't recover the way they would like to. And so they would like us to work with them on the Thursday before Memorial Day, before you gasp or you say, I don't know how that worked. Brian and I both have had experience of trying a Memorial Day weekend graduation before, and it actually was somewhat of a hit. We weren't too sure at the time either, but if you think about parents and graduation parties and bringing guests in from the outside, it could be a positive. And so if we did it Thursday night, you could hold graduation parties that weekend. You got guests already there in for the weekend if they're coming from any distance, and it would be a good weekend to hold it. If you're one who travels away from Memorial Day weekend, we still leave that Friday through Monday available to do that by doing it on Thursday versus a Friday. It would result in our seniors being out of school potentially a little earlier. Mary and I actually were talking about school calendar earlier, and so, as somebody who taught AP or IB classes, that is a plus with seniors. And they're done taking their tests generally in late May. Mm-hmm. Early to late May. And so really when you're done at that point, the teachers have to get really creative to keep those kids on task, because the goal of working for that test and the achievement is gone. So I don't think that's a negative thing. I think it's a positive thing as well. The location, and we would have to stagger that evening, and so we'd have about 3-hour time period to do the graduation, get the first group out, the next group in to the stadium. So, you know, potentially 5 and 8, but that's still negotiable how we do that exactly. The loons would take care of the whole setup, everything. We would have nothing, no responsibility except for to get the students there organized and go through that. They'll set up accordingly to our principal's desires and with that fit for the stadium as well. The students would sit between the grandstands and I would say halfway between them there and the pitcher's mound. That would allow the full 4,000 seats to be used for guests. If you just do a rough ballpark, that's like 15, 16 tickets per family. That's more than they get, much more
that's
than they get now.
Ballpark amount.
Those families who bring smaller amounts also will allow those tickets for people who bring larger amounts. So the odds are we would be able to fit all 4,000 there. That would be allowed for a good viewing area. The stage would be around pitcher's mound area. And it's a great, if you've ever been to the stadium, it's a great viewing area. If we were to get more than 4,000, we would have them in the grass area. Might not be the best viewing area that you would have from those areas, but I don't think we'll hit that as well. Their large screen is a benefit for parents as well. Their sound system to hear is a benefit, certainly mm-hmm. for grandparents, parents as well. And they would allow us a copy of the ceremonies, and we would be able to pre-sell those for memorabilia, offset a little bit of our cost there as well. We would have a little cost because we would still need to set up our gymnasium's skeleton. We'd make that call about noon. You'd make the safe call if there's any chance for weather, you're going inside. And so you would be back at school the way we've done it traditionally. We've also had experience with that. And so my 17 years as administrator, graduated outside. The gym was set up as a backup. And 13 of my 17 years there, we graduated outside. I think two of the years that weren't with them had actually the years my children graduated, so they probably weren't real happy. But I think it'll work well. I think you could have a few people question Thursday before Memorial Day, so I want you to be prepared for that. But I think if we try that first year, my experience is it could become a positive date that may be a preferred date if we were going forward from there. And so we've done nothing more than had initial discussions with the loons. They want to move forward if we can. And they booked that far out.
Oh, yeah.
And so if I hear no objections, you know, I'd like to move forward with that piece of it.
Well, it directly affects my family.
Aren't you excited?
I
would be very excited.
And I would say my daughter was excited because that means she's done a week earlier.
Well, I was hoping it wouldn't be too big of a change because I was hoping we were starting school a week earlier. But as of today, I was informed that this late notice that the Teacher Association is not willing to change that their calendar by a week. So that is off the table for now. We'll look at it again for the 2018 year.
No, it'd be the year after.
19 school year. okay? And we'll take a look at that again, because our waiver, once I get official notification, is for 3 years. Plus, you know, there's legislation on the table that may make that mute anyway, that will have the flexibility Tuesday through Thursday, if you recall that language, it won't let you go Monday and Friday. So we could get 3 days possibly early if that legislation goes through. So we'll look at that as we go forward as well. But once we're out, the whole county has to go. So it did affect the other three school districts who were ready to make that change as well. So that is not going to occur. Central Park Outdoor Learning Environment, I sent that to you because I really want you to have the ability to know of those generous people who donate to that project. And let's reach out to them to thank them. I mean, what an amazing project. You know, Brian and I were chuckling having be relatively new to this community for us to raise that kind of dollar in another community. But it took us 5 to 10 years, huh, Brian? And this happened over, what, 3 or 4 months. What a great community to do that. And I'm excited about those outdoor learning spaces as well. As Patrick mentioned about Jeff Lauer taking on a new challenge, we've been studying this for a while. It's been a little bit of a pet peeve for me when we lose kids to alternative CTE programs. I certainly, what a great job the Juvenile Center does. I don't really want kids to go there. I want to prevent that from occurring earlier. And so we do send a number of kids to alternative programs for alternative diplomas or GED programs, and I'd like to try to prevent that. And you know, I think Brad, this speaks to your field as well, is I really have noticed that back when I was a high school principal, we had a tech center, and when I sent some of my kids who didn't do well with 6 hours of sitting in a classroom, and suddenly they went off and they did 3 hours of welding or electrician or building trades, they came back and all of a sudden they were good students in the other three core classes. And so it was relevant to what they were doing. They shortened the amount of time period where they were sit and get, and they were actively engaged in an area that they were concerned about. They knew it was going towards a career focus. So we took that CTE component plus the ability to blend online personally where they need, similar to what Juvenile Kids shared with you tonight, something that was tailored to their personal needs. And so that's our goal, to do that and keep all our own students in MPS, get them all an MPS diploma, allow them to continue to participate somewhat in the general setting when they're out in CTE, or they do want to participate in the arts, music, athletics, they would be able to do so, but we would pull that piece off. So right now we're looking at holding it in the Midland High Annex. We have explored the possibility of Carpenter, but as you know, we got that maybe going for Robotics Center part of it, but we're also exploring one day, do we need that for our younger, young fives, preschool type programs as well. And so we want to go cautiously what we do with Carpenter before we make that decision. So that's up and going. Jeff's going to run that. And we've got some pretty neat ideas and a lot of work to do before next fall to get that up and going. So that's all I have for you tonight.
All right.
Well, with that, we will end the board meeting at 8:31. Thank you, everybody.